All right, hello and happy Sunday. Blessed Sunday to all of you. We are believers together in Christ, for Christ, believing in His soon to come return for the church, believers together. Yes, we are. My name is Pastor Bob Tarasiak, and I am the leader of this Believers Together church, the virtual church online, as we come together to celebrate the power, the glory, the majesty of our Lord Jesus Christ today and forever. We welcome you this morning. We're glad to be here to be part of Believers Together as we continue to grow in God's grace and the sanctification power of the Holy Spirit of God. Just as an opportunity to let you know that this is the first Sunday of the month, June 4th, in the year of our Lord 2023. Wow. And so just to let you know, we are celebrating the Lord's Supper after the message this morning, so don't forget to get your wine or grape juice and your piece of bread, whatever it is, unleavened bread if you want, or a cracker, juice, to come and join us after the message this morning as we celebrate and remember what Jesus did for us on the cross, our redemption, our atonement, our propitiation found in Him. And just as you know, if you do have any prayer requests, please send them to me at rtarasiak@gmail.com. You can go to believerstogether.org. believerstogether.org to find information about what we're about, what I'm about, what we do together, and especially for those who are tired of religion, tired of man-made doctrines and things of that nature, and they really just want to connect and grow in biblical truths, you're at the right place. Don't forget also every Tuesday, this Tuesday we're continuing in our Galatians series, verse by verse through the Bible, this Tuesday, and that'll be the 6th of June, in the year of our Lord 2023, and it'll be at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So 7 p.m. we'll continue in our verse-by-verse study of the book of Galatians, Apostle Paul's letter to Galatia. And also on every Thursday, we're continuing in the book of Isaiah, the prophet, the major prophet Isaiah in the Old Testament. And that is at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, in the afternoon Eastern Time, 1 p.m. And again, both of these teaching sessions, I do send out emails, or it'll be on believerstogether.org or on the Facebook page, San Felipe Believers. You'll find the handouts for that teaching. You can print out the PDF files and give you the Google Meet link. It's an online interactive video where we're live streaming to each other, and we ask questions and talk about, and we grow in the wonderful Word of God. So we welcome you to be part of that on Tuesdays at 7 p.m., Thursdays at 1 p.m. And also, besides the Lord's Supper we're going to have today, these are the handouts that we come together and follow. It's got the Lord's Supper today, reminder, the date. It's got all the words for the songs to sing along with, for the words we're going to praise. Then it gives you the message title and the series there. We're going to be in 1 Peter, series part 9. It's a sub-series C, the second teaching section of Apostle Peter. And the title is Built on the Foundation of Christ, and it's 1 Peter 2, 6 through 8. And then after that, it gives you the sermon points, the first three points. Then we do the Lord's Supper, and there's a closing song. And then at the end of it, you can see if you'd like to give help the ministry of myself and my wife, Mariana, you can send tithes and offerings to my address, or you can do electronically through Zelle or PayPal, and you can get information online at the website at believerstogether.org, or print this out. And this is also, again, this handle's on the San Felipe Believers Facebook page if you want to have that. All right, so we're going to get started. Again, prayer requests, send it to me, rtarasiak@gmail.com. Mara and I would love to be praying for your prayer needs. A family that prays together, stay together, a church that prays together, stays together. God wants to hear from us, and we need to hear from Him in those times where we just take a moment to hear that still silent voice of the Lord and affirm that through the Word of God, through the Bible of our Lord, the precious Savior, the Word of God, the Scriptures. We believe that we're founded on Scripture alone. There is no man-made opinion needed. All the Word needs to be properly expounded and have proper exegesis of the text, expositorially given, taught and preached to us, and understand that is true, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing the Word of God. All right, so let's just open up with prayer and we'll get started. Father, we thank You, Lord, for this day. We thank You that we can come together as a church, use virtual, use the internet for Your glory, Father, because oftentimes we know that often these things are used for other things that are not to Your glory and to worldliness and everything else. So Lord, today, during this Sunday and of our Lord June 4th, we just ask Your Holy Spirit to move in our prayer needs. Father, hear our prayers of those who are dealing with cancer, illnesses, sicknesses, physical things that are going on. And also, Father, for those spiritual battles that people are facing, depression, anxiety, whatever it may be, Father, or attack from the enemy that's trying to put doubt in our minds, or maybe not be in fellowship with other believers. Father, we just come against that. We come and we ask your favor through your grace to come down upon us and relieve us for those tensions that we have and bitterness, and that we would forgive others and be better. And Father, this morning as we come to our worship and praise time, let us sing with all our hearts, minds, and give honor and look, put our focus to you, Lord God. And also for the help of the message that I preach, Lord, let it be of you as you continue in 1 Peter. We love you and we do pray this all in Christ's name. Amen and amen. Are you washed in the blood? Is the first song. It's on your handout. Sing along with me if you please.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Well, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily in the Savior's sight? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in that blood of the Lamb? Well, are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Well, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white? Are you washed in that blood of the Lamb? Let us all be ready for the mansions bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Well, are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Well, are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Well, there's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Cleanses us from all unrighteousness and brings His grace, His gift, and went to the cross, paid for our sin. By His sovereign grace, we are made alive from our dead and our trespasses to alive, to a living God, and we live for Him, to Him, because of Him. Hallelujah. And you know, when we face spiritual battles with things that are going on in our lives, it's huge. Sometimes demons, sometimes people, you know, God, demons use things, and you know, the prince of the air, who's the Satan, God limits him, but he has attacks on us, and he uses demons to come around and try to mislead, try to deceive, try to take us away from fellowship with God. But Father, we, by the grace, hallelujah, by the Holy Spirit, we are continuing in God's grace, and by His elect, we continue by the saving power of God to continue in our faith, because we know He's the author and finisher of our faith. The battle belongs to the Lord. We have those problems.
Heavenly armor will enter the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. No weapons that fashioned against us will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we say, glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord. Power of darkness, don't end like a flood. The battle belongs to the Lord.
Yes, it does. He raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord.
And we sing glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord.
The enemy presses and hard you fear. The battle belongs to the Lord. He's our rock. Take courage, my friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord.
And we sing glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory and honor, strength to the Lord. And we sing glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory and honor, power and strength to the Lord.
Amen. The battle belongs to the Lord. Amen. There's nothing like knowing that God will avenge those enemies, God will take care of us, and the battle belongs to He. We cannot face those battles in our flesh, but in the spirit realm of God, we can face those battles. And you know, when we come to Christ, we are enlightened by the light of Jesus Christ. He is the light that shines and disperses the darkness, takes it away, cleanses us. We need to say and sing, shine, Jesus, shine.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of your darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Place, Spirit, place, set our hearts on fire. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Praise, Spirit, praise. Set our hearts on fire. With grace and mercy, send forth your word, Lord, and let to glory. Hear it here, now life's take story. Shine on me, shine on me. To shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Play, Spirit, play. Set our hearts on.
Shine your light, give us understanding, wisdom, and discernment to understand what the Lord is saying to us through Apostle Peter this morning. Father, you are the light of the world. Let your light shine in us and let us reflect that light to others. Father, just use me as a speaking oracle of God. And we thank you for your presence this moment right now. Let your love, your grace, and your Holy Spirit just overshadow us and dwell within us and peace in our hearts and minds. And transform us as we come to your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, this morning we are going to be in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 6 to 8. And remember that we are in this series of 1 Peter, the epistle of Apostle Peter, writing to the dispersed churches up in the Galatia area, which is in the south, northeast, and in Asia, where current-day Turkey is. And this is part 9. And this is a sub-series of that called the second teaching section of Apostle Peter. And basically, what we're looking here is a description of the people of God, a description of the people of God. And the title is Built on the Foundation of Christ. Built on the Foundation of Christ, our chief cornerstone. And our text is more being 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. And that's in the New Testament. If you continue way to the back, you'll find 1 Peter chapter 2, and in verses 6 through 8. And of course, it's an intro. We know that any type of major edifice or any kind of industrial building, whether it's a 20-story, 100-story building, or if it's a home, there has to be a foundation. And you know, a home is built on a foundation. It needs to be on a solid foundation. So when one starts a home to try to construct and build it, first, you know, they pour a base of cement on there to where the blocks or the bricks are going to be established upon. And then, of course, what happens is that first block, that cement block or block, brick, whatever, it has to be placed correctly and lined up perfectly and level and everything else, because remember that first block, it is the basically the guideline. The whole, all the following blocks that go next to it, on top and everything else, has to align to that chief, that main first block of cement. And so to that, you have to make sure as we're starting this foundation and building the walls, it has to be established. has to be established on that first sheet, that corner stone or corner brick. And then from there, everything aligns with it. Well, we're going to see here as Apostle Peter continues to talk about Christ as the stone, as we seen last week, the difference between Petros and Petra. Christ is the Petra, the large, giant stone versus a pebble. And so we're going to be continuing here and looking at discovering Apostle Peter in his first epistle regarding the description of the people of God as reference to the chief cornerstone, that is, the headstone, who is who? The rock of our salvation and his eternal kingdom found in only in our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, the Mashiach, the Messiah. So we're going to continue. And just as a recap, previously looked at in 1 Peter in our teachings, and through the previous 8 sessions, we looked at the salvation based on the hope inspired by Christ's resurrection. We looked at a salvation secured through a faith pending a deepened in trial. Then we looked at a salvation reported by the prophets who described its grace and glory. And then we came to the first preaching section, chapter 1, verse 13 through 2-3, a demand for holiness, a holiness demanded by God's own character. Then we looked at a holiness demanded by the costly experience of Christ's passion. And then third, we looked at a holiness expressed in genuine love responding to the gospel. And then a holiness expressed by the new life received from a gracious God. And then now we're in the second teaching section, is 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. And this is a description of the people of God. Last Sunday, we looked at a living spiritual body serving God sacrificially. And today, we'll be looking at chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. And it's a building founded on Christ as the foundation stone. And so again, this is the importance aspect of Christ and Christ alone, who is the Redeemer, who is the chief, the headstone, the head of the church of Jesus Christ, his church. So let's read our text in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. And this is God's holy word. For it stands in Scripture, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that we can come to you through this word of God, and we can learn and grow. And Father, again, use me to speak as an instrument in your hand, as an oracle of God. We love you, Father. Touch us this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So we look at now, the first point comes to this, the importance of 1 Peter's message, that number one, it's on your handout as well, is there is no shame in believing in Christ. There is no shame in believing in Christ, our Lord and Savior. Question for you all. Have you ever been ashamed of something or someone? You know, sometimes we've heard the expression, you should be ashamed of yourself. You know, how dare you do that? How dare you think that I would do something? You should be ashamed of yourself. And we say that often because, you know, this word ashamed is like, again, it's a prey on the conscience, doesn't it? We know the good and evil, and sometimes, again, you know, when mom catches a child in the lie, what happens? It's written all their face. Mom knows right away. They turn red because they're lying. Mom can see they're lying and not telling the truth. It's in our conscience, and sometimes we're ashamed of ourselves. You know, if we're caught naked or somewhere in a dressing room, someone comes in like, oh, you know, you get ashamed of those things, of our flesh and the nature of it. Well, there is no shame in believing in Christ. We are not to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, again, in hearing Apostle Peter, he's talking about, in reference to the previous scripture, if we look at that in the Word of God, that we are to be a living stone and holy people. And again, he talks about that the living stone rejected by men in the sight of God in verse 4 of chapter 2, chosen and precious, used up like living stones are being built up in a spiritual home, a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifice acceptable to God through Jesus Christ, for it stands in Scripture again. And then of course, the lay and behold. So we have to pull away hypocrisy, envy, and slander, and all those things, 1 Peter 2, 1, that we might grow in the salvation if you did have tasted the Lord is good. So in context, that's where we are today. And then he goes into here, quoting, and of course, we know Apostle Peter, Apostle Paul, Jesus, throughout the Scripture, people have quoted, New Testament quoted, John quoted Old Testament scriptures that they had currently. They didn't have the new was being written the time Jesus walked on the earth. So again, referencing that there is no shame believing in Christ, we see that Apostle Peter referenced and quoted Isaiah 28 verse 16, where he said, therefore, says the Lord God, behold, I am the one who has laid a foundation in Zion, a stone, a tested stone, a precious stone of a sure foundation. Whoever believes will not be in haste. And of course, Peter using the word haste, but he said not be put to shame. And of course, also further on, this also talks about that, about the rejection of this thing. And of course, again, Apostle Peter is quoting and looking at happened in Psalm 118 verses 20 through 23. In Psalm 118 verses 20 through 23, David wrote this: This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. Like the Psalm 118, verse 22. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. And you know, when we talk about there, when the Apostle Peter talks about in our text this morning, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 6, it says, believers in him will not be put to shame. Well, that word shame, in the definition from the original Greek word, is to humiliate, to disgrace, to put in shame. So when we look at that, we see that, you know, he's talking about whoever believes will not be disgraced, will not be humiliated. They will not be put to shame. They will not be in haste. In other words, they won't be confused. They're not ashamed because of our belief. We are to stand in boldness and never be ashamed of the gospel. Amen? It's the power of salvation both for the Jew and the Gentile. And we as Gentiles, most of us who are watching this, we are never to be ashamed of the gospel, the good news. Because it's a solid rock about salvation, the chief cornerstone, the headstone. And it's very important that we understand that. And this is the Lord's doing. And then that word, you know, it says in the Hebrew, that in Isaiah 28:16, in the ESV version, they said, whoever believes will not be in haste. Well, I looked that up, and in the Hebrew text of Isaiah 28:16, haste is to be dismayed, stricken to panic, not be disturbed or in a hurry. So when you talk about, you know, these people who are, it is marvelous in their eyes, and, you know, the believers, but believers will not be in haste. In other words, they will not have to be basically dismayed or stricken to panic. Because why? Because we have peace in our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? We've got the peace of God. That's beyond understanding. And we understand that because we are believers. And so this foundation, we understand, is the Christ. And there is no shame in believing in Christ the Lord. So Peter references Isaiah to what? To establish a premise of wisdom that whoever believes in Christ, the cornerstone, will not be dismayed, not be hurried. They will not have to have panic, nor will they be disturbed. Because why? Why? Because the Lord Jesus is chosen and precious by God the Father. Yes, because we have a precious chief stone, the stone of Zion, the Savior, the Redeemer, who is precious. God loves greatly by sending his son Jesus Christ to come, a precious and chosen stone, just as we are chosen by the Lord, predestined to come to his saving grace and to be part of the kingdom, and realize how also precious he is, and that we as believers, we don't have to be concerned, because there is no shame in believing in Christ. You know, believers can rest assured on the chief cornerstone of the Lord's drawn and chosen people. And whoever believes in him has no reason to be dismayed nor shame in being a disciple of Christ. Amen? And here's another interesting thing about what I said earlier about Romans 1:16. For Apostle Paul writing to the Roman church, he says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, Gentile. In Romans chapter 9, verse 33, talking about, again, the stone of stumbling. And even Apostle Paul is using that references from Isaiah. And it says, as it is written, behold, I'm laying in Zion a stone of stumbling and the rock of offense. But whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. Again, even Apostle Paul was quoting what Isaiah did in 28:16. So again, we see the importance and the significance of what this illustration, what this analogy that Peter is using, Paul, and even Jesus, we're going to see that in a minute, where he talks about the importance of quoting scripture, of course, of the word, but also the fact that he is that stone that they've been waiting for, the power, the authority of God come down in the flesh. And so we go to point two. Point two is this: there is honor for those who believe in Christ. There is honor for those who believe in Christ. How many of us understand what it is to honor somebody or something? Ten Commandments, Commandment 5, honor thy mother and thy father. And so when we think about honor, it's a word that basically means integrity, decency, morality, uprightness, biblically. And so honor, when we talk about that, and the scripture says to honor, so the honor is for you who believe. Look at verse 7 of our text. So the honor is for you who believe, But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. So the honor here is for you who believe. And he's saying that we have this basic, we are valuable, we're precious, that we have worth. Why? Because of Jesus Christ. Not because of anything we do, not any merits of our own or works, but because of what God's grace, what Jesus did through us, that rock of salvation, who was precious. So in Christ, believers are worthy, valuable, and precious as well. Because why? Because of Jesus. Because of Jesus, his sheep, and the sheepfold that we are in, we are worthy, we are valuable. Not of our own merits, but the merits, the work that Christ finished on the cross for you and I. By his merit, by his work on the cross, paying the price in full for our sin, deeming us right by that sovereign grace of God, that because we were totally depraved, yet we were sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. And that's you and I. We're all sinners, we've all fallen short of God's glory, period. And that's this important thing. So because of Jesus, we are his sheep. He is the shepherd. And under him, we are valuable, we are merited, and we have because what he did for us. And there is honor for those who believe in Christ. It really is. You know, I was thinking about honor. One of the things that we try to do, I remember in the past where even ministers, reverends, pastors were honored. They were, you know, given respect and authority. Even today, I think many times we don't see that honor, to honor those in office, honor people. We almost despise and ridicule and try to slander and everything else. There's no respect for that position. Well, just like we should honor our Father in heaven, we honor our parents, we ought to honor each other and remember to put others first, to love even your enemies, Christ said. And so I think that's missing in today's society. What's in it for me is the attitude. What can God do for me? Wait a minute. What can you do for God? What can I do for our Lord to serve him and to tell others the good news? We are to go in the Great Commission and make disciples, be there for others, to love them and reveal the kingdom of God that is within us, that the Holy Spirit indwelt in us, the truth of the Word of God, the truth that says, I am the way and the truth. No one comes to the Father except through me. That's what Jesus said. Through him alone. This is the good news, and we have redemption. We've been, precious blood of Jesus paid for us in full, all our sins. And again, the reality check is this. The truth, which is being shunned everywhere today, is that we are all sinners. I don't care whether sin it is, whether it's homosexuality, adultery, stealing a penny, stealing $1 million, dishonoring God, using God's name in vain, slandering God's name, go on and on and on, stealing, robbing, coveting. I mean, you feel one out of the Ten Commandments, you feel them all. And that's the bottom line, and that's the truth of Scripture. And so because of Christ, we are only honored because of his glory and honor that he deserves, and we are part of that honor, you who believe. But there are some who don't believe, and that brings us to our next point. Point three is there is only stumbling for those who disbelieve. There is only stumbling for those who disbelieve. Think about, let me ask you a question. How many of us have friends, even family, who are not believers of Christ? How many? 2, 3, maybe 10, who knows how many? How many people know you, maybe you made an acquaintance, or a friend, or a co-worker, or somebody you, maybe even in a church. They go there because it's a social club. They don't go to worship, honor God, and be part of God's fellowship, but they go there because of an ulterior motive, some selfish motive, who knows what. I've met people like that before as a pastor in churches where their motive isn't to go and worship God, it's to look at others and see what I can gain or make business connections and stuff. That's not why we go for fellowship. We go in fellowship to worship and praise God for salvation that is beyond anything we can do for the gift of God. How many other things that people stumble those who believe? Remember, these people, they reject the truth of Jesus Christ. They reject it. Instead of receiving when God draws, they reject it. And God knows his elect. God knows who are his. The sheep know, the shepherd knows the voice. And we know the voice of the shepherd. Because God's opened the eyes of those who are his elect and draws his chosen ones and sees the truth. And they can only but repent that comes from God and be able to say, Lord, thank you, Lord. You're my Savior. You know, those who confess to Jesus, Lord, and he raised from the dead, you will be saved. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Romans 10:13. That is power. And that's the word of God. Amen. So there's only stumbling for those who disbelieve. How many times have you mentioned Jesus, right? Or brought up your faith to a person or group, and all of a sudden they become offended and they stumble over the truth of Christ? Yeah, oftentimes. I've met many different places, many people from Mexico to Italy to Massachusetts to, you know, Honduras. There are people that just says, oh, no, this, you know, I remember John Henry knows we had a mission work in Yayupe, it's called the city. And we went to Mariana's distant cousin, and I, you know, we quote scripture talking about the Bible, and he said to me, you know, that book's man-made. This is man-made, it's not of God. And I said, oh, no, this is divinely inspired, 2 Timothy 3:16, that this is the holy inspired word of God that's ready to rebuke and reprove and teach and bring people the truth. This is all God's, and this word has never been disproved, nowhere, no time. Prophecy is being revealed to us in his days as we speak even. So it's the word of God is the truth. And so again, when we talk about the stumbling for those who disbelieve, it's a total rejection, and that's what he's saying here. You know, the believer, those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. What do we mean by, you know, he's basically, Peter is referencing Psalm 118, verse 22, and that's what it says. Psalm 118, 22 says, the stone that the builder rejected has become the cornerstone. And I want to talk about this because Jesus himself quoted Psalm 118, 22. And here's what Jesus said in Matthew, the tax collector, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21, verses 42 through 44. Write that down. Matthew 21, 42 through 44. And Jesus said to them, verse 42, Have you never read in the Scriptures? Stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and is marvelous in our eyes. Matthew 21, verse 43. Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on the stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. Well, back to the verse in Peter where he talks about, and the same thing about that, where Peter talks about the stone and the builders in that verse. Well, who were these builders, quote unquote, that Peter, Dr. Luke, and Jesus quoted from David in Psalm 118:22? Well, these builders were the Jewish religious builders, the chief priests, the scribes and Pharisees, who basically built the people, or should I say, directed them to build on their carnal privileges, the tradition of elders, and their own legal righteousness, self-righteousness, traditions of man, customs of man, these things that they were doing. These were the builders that the psalmist was talking about, that Jesus was talking about. And see, basically, they refused to receive Jesus as the Messiah, the promised Messiah, and to believe in him. They refused to own and honor him as King of Zion. They refused his doctrines and his ordinances. They refused to hear him preach and suffer, or suffer others to hear him. They refused to make use of him in the spiritual building, either to preach him themselves or allow others to do it. They rejected Christ with contempt, and they set him aside and preferred a thief and a robber whose name was Barabbas. Remember when they said, you know, let Barabbas go, and Pilate said, okay, you can have the bloods on your hands. And the Jewish people and all these builders went and crucified the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But the idea and God's premise of not living by time, space, and merit, the destiny, predestined those things to happen to Jesus, and of course hardened these hearts, and these hearts were hardened, and they rejected. The builders and those leadership at the time of Christ and even in the past rejected the chief cornerstone, the headstone of the church, the Messiah. You see, the problem is here is that Christ is exalted. Not the problem, but the thing is that we understand as who God, who is enlightened, that Christ is exalted above all. He is the head of principalities and powers, above the angels, above all those things. He is made higher than the kings of the earth, and he is. And he is the head of the body, the church. So Christ truly, in this text and understanding, is the headstone, the chief cornerstone for the believers of God's elect. But for those who do not believe, Christ is a stone of stumbling, a rock of offense that will stumble them and crush them because of their disbelief and rejection of Jesus as the Messiah. You know, Apostle Paul affirmed the same premise of Apostle Peter in his epistle to the Roman church, about declaring how the Jewish leadership aspiring to achieve self-righteousness, did not succeed in their works and their self-righteousness, but yet stumble over Jesus because they refused to hear the truth. Let me share Romans chapter 9, verses 31 through 33. Romans 9, 31 through 33. But that Israel, who pursued a law that would lead to righteousness, did not succeed in reaching that law. Why? Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as if it were based on works. They have stumbled over the stumbling stone, as it is written, again, here it is again, the same quote from Isaiah, "Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame." Again, we're not ashamed, but because of disbelief, because they had no faith, they were trying to pursue it by self-righteousness, not by faith. Forsaking all, I trust him. F-A-I-T-H. Forsaking all, I trust him. Forsaking all religion of man. Forsaking all traditions of man. Forsaking all a works-based type of salvation. And no, it's about a relationship with the Father God through Jesus Christ alone. Well, why did they reject Jesus? Well, it says there, verse 8 in our text, the 1 Peter chapter 2. A stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey what? The word. See that, verse 8? They disobey the word as they were, here's a key, destined to do. See? So they disobey the word, the truth. They disobeyed God and the Messiah, the Christ. And secondly, these who disobey were destined to do so. You see, God knows all things. He's not limited by time, space, and matter. He knew that these religious leaders and people who were blinded by the God of this world were destined to disobey Christ and his word, yes, even the prophetic words of the Old Testament, and in particular the prophetic words of Isaiah and David, which we've already read and seen. So in God's sovereignty, in his plan, not ours, in his purposes, you know, these religious leaders and people rejected the truth that Jesus is the Christ. This was their destiny per Apostle Peter. Not my opinion. You read the word, they disobeyed the word because as they were destined to do, God knew the destiny of these people. They were so hardened that they didn't want to receive the truth. They rejected it. So that word destined in the Greek is tithami. Again, in the Greek, destined is tithami. It's defined as to assign someone to a particular task, function, or role. To appoint, to designate, to assign, to give a task to. So God tasked these people to not receive. I mean, this is the truth. He appointed, he designated, he assigned them to reject that was going to happen. Because in God's plan, when they rejected it, they crucified him. And that's what God needed to do, to have him crucified to pay the price of our sin. It all worked in God's plan and purpose and his sovereignty. This is the truth. So God assigned, designated these Jewish leaders to their destiny for his purpose and plan in rejecting the truth of the rock, the headstone, the chief cornerstone, that is only Jesus, the Mashiach, the Messiah, the Christ. You know, when it comes to destination and destiny, you know, speaking of destined and destiny and what happens in our lives, well, there was in Ohio, there's a certain courthouse which stands in a very unique location. Raindrops, you know, when it rains, that fall on the north side of the building, basically go into Lake Ontario and the Gulf of St. Lawrence, while the other side of the roof go down into the Mississippi River and eventually go to the Gulf of Mexico. So at precisely the point of the peak of the roof, just a gentle puff or a little wind can determine the destiny of many different raindrops. It will make a difference of more than 2,000 miles as to their final destination. Wow. Well, the spiritual application is clear here. By the smallest deed or choice of words, we might set in motion influences that could change the course of others' lives here and now, and could also affect their eternal destiny. Wow. Just as raindrops, a little wind can blow it the wrong way to that can mean a vast big difference of purpose of life, which direction they take, where their destiny is. Well, my question for you and all this message about the rock and about Jesus and the cornerstone and what it believers are believe and to receive and not reject this gospel, what is your destiny? What is your destiny? Are you destined to enter into the heavenly realm of the Lord? Or is your destiny into the pit of hell? I report you decide. I can't change you, People around you can't change you. Only the Lamb of God, Jesus the Lord, He can bring a difference in your life. He can, He's the author and finisher of faith. He, when we trust Him, He can draw us to the truth. He opens our eyes. And when we realize we're sinners, when we realize that hell is a reality, the only way out of that destiny is to be through Jesus Christ. By His gift, charis, the gift, the grace of God, He pays the price on the cross for us, and we can enter through the cross and go to our heavenly home, destined to be eternally with the peace and love of God, the Father and Savior, in the heavenly realm, in His domain. So the question is, where is your destiny? Where are you destined to be after your last breath here? Where will your next breath be? Folks, this is a serious matter. Today, repent of sin. Tell God you're sorry for the times you failed Him. And tell Him thank you for forgiveness of your sin that He paid on the cross. And then when you confess Him as your Lord and Savior, Christ comes into your life, into your being. And you, your spirit that was dead, now comes alive, that was totally separated, has been born again, a new beginning. And you can walk knowing that you have eternal life. And then after, read your Bible, get in fellowship, continue to serve our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to go into our Lord's Supper now, so get your grape juice and your cracker ready, or whatever. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And we're going to talk about the importance of the Lord's Supper. Remembering, this is about remembrance. They came together on the feast of Passover. Jesus and the apostles, disciples were there in the upper room. And they came together to break bread and drink wine. And they came together. And Jesus made an important point in John 6 about that Last Supper, about His body, His blood, what happened to Him. And it was about the Passover lamb. Jesus metaphorically became the Passover lamb. They didn't eat Him metaphorically. They knew it was a spiritual. Yes, physically He went to the cross. He shed, put His body on there voluntarily, and He shed His blood for us to pay for those sins, because the Bible says, well, the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. So He did that as the Lamb, the animal of God. And so in 1 Corinthians, Apostle Paul reminds the Corinthian church that we are to take a time, a moment, to make sure that we reflect upon us and make sure that we are receiving, partaking of this bread and this cup, that we should look at our hearts and see, make sure that to examine ourselves during this time, so that we know that, because this is truly for what? It's not for unbelievers, non-believers, but it's for believers. So, your wine and your juice, or bread and juice, the Word of God says in 1 Corinthians that, for I received from the Lord, I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when He betrayed, took bread. When He had given thanks, He broke it and said, this is My body, which is given for you. And to do this in remembrance of Me. Let us now partake and remember what Jesus did with His body on the cross. Amen. And again, after supper, when they ate the bread, He took the cup. And Jesus said, this cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this often as you drink it in remembrance of Me. For often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. This resembles and metaphorically is significantly saying that, yes, Jesus' blood was what happened on the cross. And He spilled it, and He paid in full for our sin. We remember this now as we partake, as we drink. Father God, we thank You, Lord, that we can come to you and remember what you did on the cross for me, making it for us, making it personal. Personal, not religion of man, not some religious ritual, but truly remember, has it impacted our lives, me personally, you personally. Thank you, Lord, for the relationship that God you wants only through your son Jesus, the one mediator between God and man. Thank you, God, that we have a living God, Jesus, the only one who was alive and rose from the grave and ascended back into heaven, and now talks and mediates for us. Father, we appreciate, we love you, we thank you for the Lord's Supper, that we remember what he told us to do as we continue to do this in remembrance as often as we can to remember what you did on that cross, Father. We thank you. We do pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You know, it's in moments like these that I want to sing out a song to say, I love you, Lord. It's moments like these when we're down and out or trodden on and we feel hopeless and things aren't going well. Even when things are going well, we just say, thank you, Lord. But it's in moments that we have to remember and say, man, I sing this song to say, I love you. Let's close our closing song. In moments like these, I sing out a song. I sing out a love song to Jesus. In moments like these, I lift up my hands. I lift up my hands to the Lord. Singing, I love you, Lord. Headstone, the chief cornerstone, and we thank you, Lord God, for the words to Apostle Peter, Paul, and Jesus, and all the writers of the Bible that have given us this inspired word from you, Father. Father, help us in our daily walks with you, Lord, to be strong, healthy, and bold, to reach out to others and make disciples in the name of Christ. We love you, Lord, and we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Y'all have a great, blessed week. And remember, we have Tuesday, we have Bible study. We continue in the book of Galatians on Tuesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. And just send an email. You can check on believerstogether.org for the information for that. And also Thursday, this Thursday, we continue on Isaiah at 1 p.m. Eastern Time. So again, believerstogether.org, and you can support us through the website and information how you can help and support this ministry of Believers Together. We love you. God bless you all. And have a blessed week in the Lord. Bye-bye.